Hey, Grokites, in case you can't tell from the rings on my cheek, today we're gonna grok the Olympics. And we're gonna grok an aspect of the Olympics you may have never considered before, the science behind the Olympics. Sure, the Olympic Games are chock full of jocks, no offense, Sean White, but it's science that really runs the show. Let's break down three crucial scientific factors behind those amazing feats of strength and skill, and find out about what really brings home the gold. Number one, Olympians are not normal. Most people are in awe of Olympic athletes, and there's a good reason for that. Even the guy or gal who comes in last at the Olympics is still far better at any sport than anyone you know. Unless you know people who happen to be Olympians, in which case, hey, big fan. The anatomy and physiology of your average Olympic athlete is not just amazing, it's kind of otherworldly. David Epstein, in his book The Sports Gene, explains that Olympians have bodies and genetics that are beyond exceptional, and they fall way beyond the bell curve. Seriously, they're not normal. Michael Phelps, for example, has like special hands and feet that make him an exceptional swimmer. And imagine if you were a runner who had an extremely high tolerance for oxygen deprivation. So not to make you feel bad or anything, but if you're anything close to normal, you'll probably never be an Olympic athlete. Unless you actually are one, in which case, hi again. Number two, Olympians are swole in all the right places. I didn't know what that meant until my producer Noe told me. Swole. There may actually be anatomical things about you that can prevent you from achieving your Olympic dream. I was a sprinter in track when I was in middle school. I also had the body of a 12-year-old until I was 16, so I was exceptionally fast and very svelte. But even though I was an excellent sprinter, I actually didn't have the endurance to be a good long-distance runner. There are actually different kinds of muscle fibers in your body that will determine if you'll be a good long-distance runner or someone who's more like Carl Lewis. He was a sprinter. And you guessed it, your genetics determine what proportion of muscle fibers you have in your body. For example, fast twitch fibers are good for sprinting, and slow twitch fibers are good for long distance running. So depending on if you have a lot of slow twitch or a lot of fast twitch fibers, that's gonna determine if you're a good sprinter or long distance runner. And while there are exceptions, training can only do so much to change the distribution of fibers in your body. So I guess the lesson is, bloom where you're planted. If you want to be a long distance runner, but you're only good at sprinting, don't blame yourself. Just blame your lack of slow twitch fibers. It's a little medical joke. Number three, it's all in your head, or a lot of it is in your head. When I look at the Olympics, I feel proud of my country and excited for the thrill of competition. Physical prowess and anatomy are just two aspects of the science that it takes to make an Olympic athlete. The amount of mental strength and psychological toughness that is required to compete in any level of athletics is exceptionally demanding. But the kind of training that makes an Olympian is literally all-consuming. We're talking about hours of every single day of these athletes' lives that are dedicated to training, to repetition, to intense concentration, and pain and injury on top of all that. In addition to working their bodies to the limit, Olympians need to be prepared to fail, to literally and figuratively fall down over and over again and get back up. Olympians also have to deal with the unfairness they may experience, especially in subjectively judged competitions of the Olympics, such as gymnastics, diving, and figure skating. So my Olympic beanie goes off to not only the physical exceptionalness of all the Olympic athletes, but also to their emotional and psychological strength as well. They endure this pressure for their fulfillment, but also so that we can watch them compete. So that we can celebrate their wins and feel the pain of their losses. So as you can see, the Olympics really are all about science, which still doesn't explain why curling is a sport. Love you, curlers. Thanks for watching, enjoy the Olympics, and go USA. I don't know. For more coverage on the Olympics, go over to GrokNation.com.